Now, today we discuss about the relation. So, existence and non-existence of connection between the ordered pair of objects in a definite order, that is called a part of relation. So, here we can say A, B, which is equal to C, D. This is the ordered pair of A, B. It is the ordered pair of C, D. Both are equal only if and only if A equal to C and B equal to D. So that is nothing but a existence or non-existence of connection between the certain ordered pair in definite order. It is called as a relation. So here that ordered pair is equal only if A equal to C and B equal to D. So now next we can take the definition of the Cartesian product, or we can say what is the product set. So product set, we can say it is a A cross B, which is nothing but A comma B, such that A is a member of A and B is a member of B, where this A is a set and small a is a set element of set A. Here B is a set and this small b is the element of set B. That is also called as a Cartesian product of A cross B, which is nothing but A comma B, in which the first element should be consist of the set A element and second element which is consist the part of the set B element. The another thing we have to also know that A cross B not equal to B cross B, because we can say that the follow the Cartesian product follow the concept of ordered pair. So we say that A cross B not equal to B cross A. Now the next thing we can discuss about the relation. We say that relation R from the A to B. We can say from relation R on set A to set B. And now we can represent in the form of A cross B. Now we can take another relation as on set B to C. It should be represented in the form of as a Cartesian product of B cross C. So first of all, how we can say it is related or it is not related? So one thing we have to do, and that is so now it is a relation R on set A to B, which is a subset of A cross B. So here we can take this is the relation from A to B, where the first element should be addressed, that is a part of set A, and second element should be occur at the part of set B. So the meaning is that if suppose the A cross B is generated in the form of A comma B, or we can say the element of A equal to A B C D, and element of B we can contain X Y Z. Now it is an A comma X, then A comma Y, then we can take B comma Z and D comma Y. Like that we have to just create one relation, sort of part of relation, in which first element should be occur, and that we have to generally told as a relation R in between the A and B. So the first element should be occur from the set A. So we can say first element from set A and this second element of ordered pair, it is come from the set B. So how it should be represented in the form of we can just write the A comma B is a member of R, In general way, we can write A comma B is a member of R where A is related to B, or we can say A relate B. Now A comma B is not a member of R, that symbol indicates for not a member of relation R, then we can say A is not related to B, and in symbol we can write A not related to B. So that is the way in which we have to represent A comma B is a member of R. That means nothing but A related to B, and if it is not related to B, then we can just write relation, we can just write down the cross now. So if R is a relation to itself, if R relation to itself, then we can use the product of A equal A cross A. So that is nothing but subset of A cross A, that is relation to itself, then we can create a Cartesian product in the form of A equal to or A cross A, in which we can create a subset of A cross A. So now the next one, we can find what is the domain and what is the range of the relation. So here we can take a set A which is created 1, 2, 3, 4, and now set B we can create X, Y, Z, and now we have to take the relation which is nothing but 1, Y, 1, Z and 3, Y. Like that we can take any relation in between the set A and set B. Now what we can do here, first we can find out what is the, in that relation, what is the domain and what is the range. So domain is nothing but the first element of the relation which will be treated as a domain part, and the second element of the relation of ordered pair which will be treated as a range part. So here in this example we can treat domain equal to 1, 3, and what is the range? Range is nothing but second element, that is y, z, y. So y, z is treated as a the range, and this is treated as a domain. So in any problem we have to given the relation and we can find out what is the domain, and then you can easily find the first element of the relation will be treated as a domain and second element will be treated as a range. So in general we can just define a mathematical notation of domain. The definition is a A such that we can find A is a, the next part we can discuss, which is A is a member of A, and A comma B is a member of relation R. That is a member of A, it is indicated from the set A, and for the sum, for sum, B is a member of B. That is a part of domain. So in domain we can say, if it is a part of relation, if this ordered pair A comma B is a member of relation, and the set A, small a is a member of set A, then the A content will be treated as a, first element will be treated as a domain. What is the range? The range is equal to B such that B is a member of B, and A comma B is a member of R, and from sum A is a member of A. So here that concept we have to indicate, that is only second part we can consist in the case of range, and first element we can consist in the part of the domain. So that is the part in which we can find out what is the domain and what is the range. So now, next we can discuss what is the inverse relation. Inverse relation we have to represent in the form of the symbol R inverse. It is when we can say a relation which can be given from set A to set B. It is called the relation. The inverse of relation is nothing but the reverse order relation, that is nothing but the relation from set B to set A. So here a relation from set A to B and R inverse the relation from set B to A. So here we can take an example, A equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. Now B equal to, we can take the set element x, y, z, and relation is like that, 1 comma x, 1 comma y, and 3 comma z. So we have to take the relation, this one. Here as we know, what is the domain and what is the range. Domain is the relation, first element is domain and second element will be treated as a range. Here we can find R inverse. R inverse is nothing but, it is x comma 1, we can just reverse the order, x comma 1, here it is y comma 1, here it is z comma 3. So this is the R inverse. Another thing you have to also know, R inverse of inverse equal to R relation. So inverse of inverse is nothing but the come to the original relation R. So now the R inverse, definition of the R inverse is mathematically, you can write R inverse equal to B comma A such that A comma B is a member of R. So that is the definition of the R inverse, where whatever the element A comma B is a member of R, we can just reverse in the way B comma A such that A comma B is a member of R. So that is called the inverse relation. Now the next part we can discuss, which is representation of relation on finite set. Representation of relation on finite sets. So the relation can be represented in the two ways, one in the matrix representation and another representation which is called as a, there is a two disjoint way we have to represent the part of relation. So first we can say what is the matrix representation of the relation. So matrix representation of relation. So in that relation we have to take the two sets, and what is the relation should be occurred. Suppose here we can take the value of A equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and value of B we can take x, y, and z. And what is the relation we have to take? 1 comma x, 1 comma y, and 3 comma z. Just as we have told this type of relation, we have to take an example and we can solve what is the matrix representation of this relation. So it is a 1, 2, 3. We have to take our relation from the three tuples 1, 2, 3. This is x, y, z, and relation will be treated as a y comma 1 comma y, 1 comma z, and 3 comma y. So that is the relation you have to mention. Now how to represent the matrix representation in the form of the row is nothing but the element of A. So here the column will be in the element of B and row will be in the element of A. Now here we have to take the matrix representation. We can entry only 1 and 0. 1 indicate whether the relation is exist, relation exist, and 0 indicate the relation does not exist. So if suppose 1 comma x is relation existing, so here we can take 1 comma x, the value become 1. 1 to y there is a no relation, so here we can put the 0 entry, because that's binary relation in the form of Boolean algebra. So whether the relation is exist, we can treat it as a value 1. If the regression does not exist, we can treat it as a value 0. So the next is the 1 to z, that is exist the relation. So here we can take the value 1. So here next 2 to x, there is no relation exist, the value becomes 0. Again 2 to y, no relation, value 0. 2 to z, no relation, 0. 3 to x, there is no relation, because again 0. 3 to y, that is exist a relation, so here 1, and 3 to z, no relation, it again 0. So that represents the metric representation of the relation on a finite set. So here we can take the two finite set A and B, and the relation will become this one. So this only the three elements should be encountered in the relation part ordered pair, so we can exist in the form of matrix representation. So here one thing you have to remember again, this x, y, z, that is nothing but the element of B, and in the row wise we can represent the element of A. So these are the element 1, 2, 3, and these are the element of B, which is represented in the form of column wise. So it is the row wise, it is, we can treat it as a column wise. So that is the matrix representation. Now the next one is, and it is also called the matrix of relation. So this type of relation we can also call as a matrix of relation. So now this is the one part of the relation. Second, we can take it as an arrow diagram of the relation. Arrow diagram to represent relation. So in this arrow diagram to represent the relation, we can say like that, if the A element contains the set 3 element and B set we can consist of x, y, z. What is the relation? Relation is the 1 comma x and 1 comma z and 3 comma y. So now the arrow diagram says there is a, what the number of finite set we can take into a disjoint disk. We can take two disjoint disks, one is the A, set A, another is from set B. In set A, we can consist three elements, we can put this element into a circular disk, and in this another element we can consist in set B, which is x, y, z. Now it is the relation R, in which we can consist the first element relation from 1 to x, that the arrow indicates from the source to destination, that is 1 to x. Second relation from 1 to z, that is the 1, and that indicates from the arrow towards z. And third one from 3 to y, it is 3 to y. So that diagram, it represents the relation with the help of arrow diagram. So there are two ways to represent the relation. First is we can represent with the help of matrix representation, another we can represent with the help of arrow representation. So now here we can say these all are the parts. 1 is a member of A, here we can say x is a member of B. So this is the part we have to say, arrow representation of relation. So now next is directed graph of relation. Relation on sets. Directed graph of relation on set. So when R is a relation, when R is a relation on a finite set, so we can represent it in the help of directed graph. So tell me first, what is a directed graph? So first we can start with a graph. A graph is nothing but a pair of two things. One is the set of vertices and another is the set of edges, where V is nothing but set of vertices and it is is the set of edges. So here we can consist V equal to V1, V2 up to Vn, and the edges consist of E1, E2, and so on up to En. In directed graph, we can say there is a direction between the source to destination. So when one point to another point, it will be give the direction, that is called a directed graph. In a directed graph, we can consist of two things. One is the parallel edge, another is the self loop. So in directed graph, we can also consist of parallel edge as well as we can consist of the self loop. So how the directed graph of relation on a set should be represented? We can give one relation, and that relation we can represent in the form of directed graph. So here we can take a relation from 1, 2, 2, 2, then 1, 3, 3, 2, 4, 4, and like that, 1, 2, 3, 4, and we can take another is the 2, 3, and like that. We can take this relation, and in that relation, how to represent the directed graph? So first of all, foremost thing is that we can identify how many number of vertices are required. So in that case, there is a total number of element is 4, 1 to 4. So we know that there is a 4 number of vertices are required. So here we can take 1, 2, 3 and 4. Now, there is a relation, first is 1, 2. So we can just in directed graph say it is relation from 1 to 2. Another relation, it is indicated from the 2 to 2. As per we can know, the properties of the directed graph is first consist self loop, and second it is consist of parallel edge. So here we can consist a self loop 2, 2, then next is 1, 2, 3, that is 1, 2, 3, then next consist of 3, 2, 2, so it is 3, it is 3, 2, 2, next consist 4, 2, 4, it is again consist of self loop, then we can again take as a 2, 4, so here we can consist a 2, 4, and next take the 3, 4, so here consist of 3, 4, so we can also take 4, 3. So here what we can take 4, 3, because they can consist of the parallel edge, so 4, 2, 3. So this the representation of the that relation in the form of directed graph. So here we can also observe that in this directed graph we can also consist of self loop and also consist of the parallel edge. In detail we can describe in a graph theory how to represent this of the directed graph and what are the properties. Certainly new properties we can encounter, we can discuss in the graph theory. So that is the way in which we can say the directed graph of relation on a set. So now the next is the composition of the relation. Next is the composition of a relation. So here we can take a three finite set, A, B, C. Now we can take a R relation from set A to B. The S relation we can take from B to C. So it is just represent A cross B subset of A cross B. It is a subset of, and it also consists of subset of B cross C. So now we can find out the A R composite relation always represented in the form of R composite S, where R is a one relation, S is another relation. We can say A R composite S to C. It is possible where A is a set of element, A is an element from the set A, small c is an element of set C. So, how it is possible? We have to take the one example in which we can more clarify whether A to C are composite as how to find out. So, here we can take the first A in set A, we can consist the A1 and like that element of A, and in set C it is the part of C. So what is A comma C only exists if there is a R composite S. There is a R composite S. There exists a, so there exists B is a member of B. B is a member of P for which A comma B is a member of R and B comma C is a member of S. So in relation R it will be consist A comma B because B is a set of element of the finite set B. So here we can say A comma C there exists, B is a member of B for which A comma B is a member of R and B comma C is a member of S. That is a S relation. So that is nothing but we can call as a R composite S. So in that case, if for some B is a member of B, we can say B is a member of B. Now A relate to B and B as to C. There is a two relation. One relation is R, which is in the form of A cross B, subset of S relation, it is a part of B cross C. So here we can take a few values, one element A comma B, which is a member of relation R, B comma C, that is B is a element of set B, it is a finite set C, it is a member of S. Now we can say if for a sum B is a member of B, we can say A relate to B and also B S, B is S relation to C. So we can say A comma C there exists, B is a member of B for which A comma B member of R and B comma C is a member of S. So now that R composite S relation we can also represent in the form of RS, that is also indicate for the composite relation. So if the R relation composite to itself, then we can represent R composite R. If R relation composite to itself, that is indicate for R composite R, that is nothing but R square. So R cube we will find out, it is R square composite R. R4 which is nothing but R cube composite of R. So that is the way in which we can find out the composite to itself. Now the next one is composite of relation to a matrix. So next one is composite of relation and matrix. So here we can take A equal to, we can take set A equal to 1, 2, 3, 4 and set B element we can take A, B, C, D and set C we can take X, Y, Z. Now we can take the three sets, three finite sets A, B, C. The value of A is, it consists of four elements and set B consists of four elements A, B, C, D differently. and in set C we can consist the three elements, namely x, y and z. So now we can create a two matrix. One we can take MR, which is the relation of R, which is nothing but the A cross B. So it should be represented in the form of AB, CB, here 1, 2, 3, 4, and we can represent the relation. Now we can take a relation from A to B in such a way that it is 1, 0, 0, 0. Now that is the relation of 1, comma A. Next is 0, 0, 0, 1. Now 1, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 0, 0. So here we can take this type of relation in which it is take the 1, 1, 0, 1. So here the relation is like that, in form of 1, comma A and 2, comma D, 1, comma A, that is 3, comma A, sorry, and 3, comma B. So that is the relation 1, comma A, it could consist of 1, 2, comma D, it consists of 1, 3, comma A, consists of 1, and 3, comma B, consists of 1. So that is the one relation. So now, another relation, we have also take here, the value is 1, so it will be treated as a 3, comma D. So total is the 5 relations, that is the 5 ordered pair we have to consist in the matrix MR. Now the another matrix is, we can consist MS. So MR is nothing but the relation from coming from the subset of A cross B. So now MS relation is in the part of X, Y, Z. Here we can take 1, 2, 3, 4. So now in that case, it is the part of we can consist of the part of the x, y, z and 1, 2 that is a B cross C. Here the S matrix is the form of subset of B cross C, so it will become under the A, B and C, D. Now we can take a certain relations, and that relation is in the second row we can take 1, sorry, in the 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. And now the another relation we have to take as 0, 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1. So in that case we can also find the relation S, which is nothing but equal to B, comma X and B, comma Z, C, comma Y and D, comma Z. So that is the relation we can find out between the matrix R, MR, and the another relation we can find out from the matrix MS. Now our problem is that we can find out the multiplication of MR into MS, which is equal to, so when we can multiply both the matrix MR and MS, at that time all the non-zero entries which will be indicate the relation of the R opposite S, or the zero entry, it will be indicate there is no relation between the R opposite S. So when we can multiply this term and we can find out the result, that is 0, 0, 0, that is X, Y, Z, here 1, 2, 3, 4. In our next value we can find out 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1 and 0, 0, 0. So here, so that the non-zero entries is matrix tell us that element written to the relation R composite S. So here what is the relation of R composite S? We can take all the non-zero entries. So this is the R composite S, and all the zero entries, there is no relation from the R composite S. So there is a two way in which we can composite relation with the help of matrix and A without using matrix we can simply represent in the form of just we can previously describe in the R composite as how to represent the relation. So that is the composite of relation with the matrix. So here the one thing we have to also know that the composite relation is follow the property of associativity. So composite relation is associative. Associative means if suppose R composite S composite T which is equal to R composite S composite T, where R is the relation from the subset of A cross B, S is a subset of B cross C, and T is the subset of, we can take the another relation that is called C cross T. So we can say R composite S of T equal to R composite bracket mein S of S composite T. So composite relation can also follow the associative property. So now the next we can discuss, this is the part of the composite relation. Now the next is the type of relation. So in type of relation, there are various type of relations to be used in discrete mathematics. First we can discuss the reflexive relation. So what is the reflexive relation? In reflexive relation, there is a relation R on set A. A relation R on set A is reflexive if A comma A is a member of R, or we can say A relate to A, or A relate to A, then we can say it is a reflexive relation. So reflexive relation, the property is, in suppose in a set A they can consist a pair 1 2 3 4. If a set A we can consist 1 2 3 4, now the relation become 1 comma 1 2 comma 1 3 comma 4 4 comma 4 and 3 comma 3 and 2 comma 2. So in that relation every element have relation to itself, it's called as a reflexive relation. So 1 relate to 1, 2 relate to 2, 3 relate to 3 and 4 relate to 4. So every pair of elements should be related to itself, it's called as a reflexive relation. So here we can follow the property A comma A is a member of R, that is every element is a member of the set A and it is also a member of relation R, A comma A. 1 comma 1 is a member of R, 2 comma 2 is a member of R, 3 comma 3 member of R and 4 comma 4 member of R, and A relate to A. So that at that time we can say that relation is a reflexive relation. So now, and we can say every element, or we can say A is a member of set A, it must be that small a is a member of set A. Here we can also say A is a member of set A. That is a reflexive relation. What is a irreflexive? Irreflexive, or we can say it is a not reflexive relation. Irreflexive relation, at least one element is exist where A comma A is not a member of R. So it is called as a reflexive relation. And so in that case we can discuss about the reflexive and it is a non-reflexive relation. So it is called as a non-reflexive or irreflexive relation. So that is the first part. Now the next is symmetric or anti-symmetric relation. So next is symmetric and anti-symmetric relation. So in symmetric relation we say that a relation R on set A is symmetric if A relate B, then B relate A. If A relate B, then also B relate A, and A comma B is a member of R, and B comma A also member of R. And A, this is the part in which we can say A comma B is a member of A. So the definition is like that. If A relate B, then also B relate A, we can say it is a symmetric relation. So here the example is that if we can take a relation A 1, 2, 3, 4, and now we can take the relation between 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 3, 4, 4, 2, 4, and 2, 2, and the 4, 2, and 2, 1. And so this is the relation we have to mention. Now we can find out whether it is symmetric or not. So it is symmetric only when A relate B, then B relate A. If suppose 1 relate to 2, then it must be 2 relate to 1. So here 2, 1 is also exist. 1 relate to 1, it is same thing. Now 2 relate to 4, 4 relate to 2. So here we can say that relation is a symmetric relation. So when we can say it is not a symmetric relation, so it is relation is called as a symmetric relation. So now when it is anti-symmetric relation, that is a relation R on a set A is anti-symmetric or non-symmetric if A relate B but B not relate to A. That is A comma B is a member of R, then B comma A is not a member of R. It is called as anti-symmetric or non-symmetric. So here the example is that if we can take a relation is 1 comma 2, 1 comma 1, and 2 comma 4, and 2 comma 2, and 2 comma 1. So that relation is anti-symmetric because the reason is that 1 relate to 2, 2 relate to 1, it is correct. But 2 relate to 4, but there is no 4 relate to 2. So that's why it is called as it is anti-symmetric or non-symmetric relation. So that is the way in which we can identify what is the symmetric or anti-symmetric relation. So now next one is the transitive relation. So it is a transitive relation. We can say if a relation R on set A is transitive if A relate B and B relate C, then A relate C. So the meaning is that A comma B is a member of R and B comma C is member of R, then A comma C also member of R. So that is the definition of transitivity. If A relate to B and B relate to C, then we can say A relate to C. So the same thing we can write: A relate to B, B relate to C, then A relate to C. That is the property of the transitive relation. So here we can take one example: A equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and now the relation is like that: 1, 1, 1, 2, and 2, 3, and 1, 3 and 4, 4. So we can find whether that relation should be transitive or not. 1 relate to 2, 2 relate to 3 and 1 relate to 3. So here we can say that type of relation is called as a transitive relation. So now the next we can discuss the what is the non-transitive relation. So non-transitive relation we can say A relate B, B relate C, but A should not relate to C, or A comma B is a member of R and B comma C also member of R, then A comma C is not a member of R. So we can say that type of relation is indicated for the non-transitive relation or non-transitivity. So that is the different type of relation. Now we can discuss the closer properties of the relation. Closer properties of the relation. So here we can know that any properties of the relation P of R, which is subset of R, and we can take this formula. In case that we can find out the property of the relation, they can maybe consist in combination of either reflexive, symmetric, anti-symmetric, transitivity. We can find that is a subset of the relation R and S. So based on this concept, we can find the different type of closure properties, and then proposed properties we can take reflexive and symmetric closure. Here we can take lambda A that is equal to A comma A such that A is a member of A. So the reflexive closure says, the properties of the reflexive closure is R union lambda, R union delta A, and symmetric closure R union R inverse. So that is the way in which we can find out the reflexive closure and symmetric closure. So it is R union delta A, and delta A, the value of delta A is equal to A comma A such that A is a member of A. So here in the A comma A, it will be indicate the diagonality element of the set A. Reflexive closure says R union delta A, where whatever the relation they can consist, there are certain missing element in the diagonal values we want to add to find the reflexive closure. In case of symmetric closure, whatever the relation is given, in that certain inverse should not be exist of the relation, so we can perform the union operation of the inverse relation, then the resultant value will be generated, which is called as a symmetric closure. So that is the part of the reflexive and symmetric closure. So in the symmetric closure, adding two pair A comma B whenever B comma A available, or whenever we can say the B comma A, or adding to all pairs of B comma A whenever A comma B, whenever the A comma B belongs to R. So that the meaning is that we can add the pair B comma A, that is nothing but inverse pair, where whenever A comma B exists in the relation, so that we can generate the symmetric closure. But in the case of this is simply adding R those element which is do not already exist in the relation, we can add all the A comma A element which A is a member of A, which are missing in the relation R, that is called as a reflexive closure. So now next part we can discuss, which is the transitive closure. So let R be the relation on set, we can find out the transitivity. So R, composite R, which is R square, now R cube equal to R square composite R, similarly R to the power n equal to R n minus 1 composite R. So that is the composite relation we can find out. So here the R star, in the case of reflexive closure, R star equal to union I equal to 1 to infinity, and we can find out R to the power I. That is the way in which we can find out the transitivity closure, where R star is nothing but the, we can treat it as a transitive closure relation of R, where R star, it is called transitive closure of relation R. So here in that case the transitivity of R, we can find the transitivity of R equal to R union R square union R cube up to R to the power n. So that is, the finding transitivity can take long time when the value of set A is so large. When the value of set is large, the transitivity is very to find, it is very difficult, and it will take the large number of times. So that is the way of the closure properties relations. Now next we can discuss, that is the equivalence relation. So in equivalence relation we can say a relation R on a non-empty set S, we can say that relation is equivalence. They can consist the three properties. One, it is a reflexive. Second, it is a symmetric. Third, it is a transitive. So if the three property or three relation properties will be consist in a relation which is called as an equivalence relation. So the equivalence relation generally used where we can use the classification of the object. When we want to find the classification of object, at that time we require the concept of equivalence relation. So the equivalence relation, it consists three properties. First, reflexive, symmetric and transitive. If consist these three, we can say it is equivalence relation. So in equivalence relation they can consist the three properties. So in that case we can say A relate to A, A is a member of non-empty set S. Here we can say A relate to B, then and B relate to A, that is we can call, and third transitivity, A relate to B and B relate to C, then A relate to C. So if the three properties would be consist, all the three properties should be hold, then type of relation is called the equivalence relation. Now it is used for classification of objects. When we want to find the classification of object, it is used the equivalence relation. Generally, the equivalence relation also used in theory of computation for finding the classification of the object. So now, the next one we can discuss that is called as a partial order relation. Or composite, first we can discuss the compatible relation. Compatible relation. So a binary relation, that is reflexive and we can call it as a symmetric, it is called as a compatible relation. So it is contained two property, one is the reflexive, another is the symmetric. So if the two properties hold a relation, that relation is called as a compatible relation. So that is nothing, reflexive, A is related to A, A is a member of non-empty set S, and symmetric, it is A related to B, then also we can say B related to A. So it is called as a compatible relation. Compatible relation consists two properties, these are reflexive and symmetric. Now we can say every equivalence relation is a compatible relation. So we can say yes, because in equivalence relation, we can say it is reflexive, symmetric and transitive. So every equivalence relation, they can consist a compatible relation, but every compatible relation need not to be equivalence relation, because in equivalence relation they can consist three properties. So out of two properties, which is same as a compatible relation, so we can say every equivalence relation is compatible relation, but every compatible relation is not equivalence relation. So that is the part of a compatible relation. Now next is the partial order relation. So partial order relation, if a relation, they can consist of two property, one is the, they can consist of three property most, that is reflexive, antisymmetric and transitive. Reflexive, antisymmetric and transitive, then we can say that type of order is called as a partial order in relation, or we can call it partial order, or we can also call it as a quotient. Partial orders and relation, they can consist of three property. One is the reflexive, that is A related to A, and A is a member of non-empty set S. Antisymmetric, A related to B, but B not related to A. And transitive, A related to B and B related to C, then A related to C. So that is called as a partial order relation. It consists three properties, and these properties are reflexive, antisymmetric and transitive. So that type of relation is called as a partial order relation, or we can also call it as a quotient, that is a partial order such relation. So in next class we can discuss about the equivalence relation with partition and n-n relation, and certain type of problems we can solve based on the relation. Thank you.